Hey everybody, it is so nice to see you all here. Welcome back to another VR News Roundup, covering not only the most popular stories over the past few days, but ones that just didn't get enough attention, and there is a tremendous amount to go over in this video. We have Apple gobbling up more VR studios, a possible consumer HTC comeback, Facebook's quest for domination, and a big possible leak for the Oculus Quest 2 that you're going to see here first. But we need to talk firstly about Facebook Kinect 7. Found first in a tweet and also on TechFB, Facebook is announcing its renaming of its entire VR and AR division to Facebook Reality Labs, and Oculus Kinect 7 is now going to be called Facebook Kinect 7. This will all take place digitally this year, as expected due to COVID, and will take place on September 16th and can be either streamed on Facebook Reality Labs page or on Oculus venues inside your headset. That's all we know mostly. More Oculus Quest 2 news is likely going to be showcased here, but it's just kind of a sad feeling. Not even one of Oculus's original founders will be present. Facebook does now, of course, require Facebook accounts to use for headsets starting in October, and the Oculus name disappearing is not how I saw VR evolving in 2020, but the dumpster fire this year is going strong, so let's just add to that. Of course, with all the recent negative news coming from Oculus and Facebook, it is likely that some large news and good news will be coming from Facebook Kinect 7, because there's no better way to battle bad press than giving really good press, because people will forget quickly. But let's also talk about something no one ever likes hearing, and that's anything about Apple, unless it's the fight of who has the larger unit between Apple and Epic. Regardless of another media monopoly entering the XR space, it's pretty inevitable it will happen. In the most recent Apple VR news, they have confirmed the acquisition of VR startup Spaces. Spaces originally had the vision of creating VR theme park attractions that could go in things like shopping malls or theme parks themselves, and it did raise a very substantial amount of funding for that vision. However, with the pandemic ending shared consumer units, at least for a small time frame, that vision was threatened, and Spaces did pivot to creating software that allowed users to have better experiences in Zoom and other video conferencing services in VR. It was confirmed on Axios that Apple acquired Spaces, another move to possibly gain exclusive platforms to give future value to the Apple XR brand. In a statement by Apple, "Apple buys smaller technology companies from time to time, and we generally do not discuss our purpose or plans." In addition, the company did not comment on if it would continue to offer Spaces video conferencing services at this time. If you head over to the Spaces website, you'll be greeted with this message: "Spaces is heading in a new direction. Thank you to our users and partners who participated in our awesome VR video conferencing product and the many people who enjoyed our VR location-based entertainment attractions found at theme parks, theaters, and more." In a way, this comes off as all business operations are ceasing for now, similar to how NextVR is in the current same spot since its Apple acquisition. I'm hoping Apple is not eating different emerging tech companies to hold on to their proprietary properties, but Apple is building a small arsenal of AR and VR products that could be exclusive to them. Let me know your thoughts. Moving on though, hear me out. One more Facebook power-hungry story, and I don't mention these to aid that overly done negative news cycle or spread Facebook fear propaganda. I have been very clear that while I don't agree with the current Facebook stance on linking accounts, I won't be leaving their ecosystem. However, in times where more and more companies are vying for full control, it's important to show these things to build awareness so we as consumers have the potential to vote with our wallets and make a change. You probably saw the pretty big news that Unity Software, the platform for creating games, has filed with the SEC to have an IPO and go publicly traded. On a side note, those who believe in XR being the future probably may want to get in on this. I'm no financial advisor, I just stayed at a Holiday Inn once. However, an old letter titled Mark's Vision from 2015 outlined Zuckerberg's manifesto on how they would like to conduct business and how they wanted to purchase Unity, which should be pause for concern. And understanding this is the best way to make purchasing decisions. Here's a few things here, and Ezwar on Twitter did a great write-up of this, so full credit goes to him for this segment. Here are a few of the most worrisome parts he made clear. As an example of superiority, if we want to make sure our avatars or identity systems work really well in Unity, we'll easily be able to do that. No one else building a competing avatar system will be able to modify the Unity engine. More or less, Basically, we make the best avatars and block all else from using the best software to make them. Next up, further, since our key services will be integrated so well and so prominently into Unity, that will put pressure on other engines like Unreal to do close integration with our key services. Basically, by owning Unity, they would leverage pressure onto competitors to also prioritize them, or those companies would get left behind. It's just another strong arm tactic to have full control of the process. On the flip side, if someone else buys Unity or the leader in any core technology component of this new ecosystem, we risk being taken out of the market completely if that acquirer is hostile. More or less, they're semi-okay with being able to do that, blocking someone from a platform, but they want to be the driver and own it all. They want to have the power to block, not be blocked. I'll end it by repeating that I am sure Facebook is not the only company with this mindset. There's absolutely no ethical capitalism for large companies, and while this segment is not to sway anyone in favor or opposition to Facebook, by not talking about it, it's just as bad in my opinion. Using Facebook isn't bad, and vilifying users for their decisions to use it is not a good look, but it's good for consumers to at least have as much info as possible for their decisions on who to support with your wallet. But of course, we need to talk about the Oculus Quest 2 and a possible leak for when it will arrive to stores, how much it will be, and any specs on it. To clarify though, this is still in the speculation zone. I cannot confirm this, but the info coming in pictures are straight from the source directly, and I fully believe these pictures are real, but of course the info in them is subject to be placeholders, they could be wrong, etc. Thank you to the source who sent these to me. I'm always down for emails or Twitter DMs for info out there, so please hit me up if you ever get something. So these are the pictures I received, and I have cropped out the device it is on and confirmed nothing on here is an identifier to the person. However, this is straight from a Target tablet for stocking, and we see some interesting info on them. There is both a 64GB version and 256GB version listed, with the former at $299, $100 less than the current Oculus Quest, and the latter version going for $399, the same price as the current Oculus Quest, but with a tremendous amount of more storage. Most notably, there is a street date of October 13th listed on both. A street date, for those unfamiliar with the jargon, is typically a date a product will be released for sale to the general public, where they receive the stock before that date, of course, to get ready for display shelves. Pricing-wise, it makes sense to me, as it is cheaper, which is what we all expected. The street date is interesting though. We know likely from Walking Cat's leaks that more info on the Oculus Quest 2 will be coming in September, and that could mean the announcement of an October release, and we'll likely know more about this at Facebook Connect 7. Additionally, the new policy of mandatory Facebook account linkings for new headset purchases also start in October as well. This would make sense if a new headset was launching and the new requirements starting at the same time. Of course, this is all speculation. This easily could be all wrong, but it's worth the share, and thank you again for sharing this with us. Let me know your thoughts. And finally, competition. It's got its pros and cons in a capitalistic society, but I think in VR specifically, we currently need more of it, mainly on the standalone or cost-effective consumer VR units. Obviously, after Facebook's recent decision of requiring Facebook logins for headset use, many want out of the Oculus ecosystem, among many other reasons such as privacy concerns, attitudes coming out of their treatment to developers, and more. Now, this may be a non-story, but I think regardless, I saw something very interesting on Twitter. Oh, we're up. A funny little quip on consumer frustrations, yet I am 100% sure not even the Cosmos reveal had this kind of fanfare that this tweet did. 24,000 likes. That's surprising to me and something that could be interesting. The Vive line consists of a lot of different headsets that get more confusing if you read into their names hard enough. But of course, the most recent HTC news revolved around the Cosmos Play, HTC's entry VR offering. Earlier this month, HTC announced the Cosmos Play would no longer be a consumer headset, but rather enterprise-focused, leaving only the $699 Vive Cosmos and $899 Cosmos Elite, not leaving much room for an entry-level headset with the Reverb, Rift S, and others out there. Straight from HTC, the product will now be targeted to businesses and institutions looking to use VR as a viewer, technology showpiece, or VR conference solution. We'll continue to work with key business customers to evaluate the best opportunities for our products. Of course, this decision was before the blowback Facebook is currently seeing. That, coupled with 24,000 likes, well, maybe HTC will reconsider and realize they have a spot for an entry-level headset that may actually have demand. My first main play headset was an HTC Vive, and honestly, I loved it. It's what built my love for VR, which showed me my first truly amazing VR experiences, and I'm 100% down for HTC to make a consumer VR comeback in the West. Let me know your thoughts, but that's gonna be it for today's video. Please leave a like if you enjoyed it, subscribe, hit that bell icon to never miss an upload. Hit me up anytime if you know anything going on in the VR metaverse, and I'll see you next time, Space Cowboys.